Hey, thanks, Dr. Young, for such a lovely introduction. And that was a very eye-opening movie. I have admired the Rockefeller University for a long time. I first set foot on this campus in the mid-1980s. It was my first time in New York City, and my glimpse of what was representatively New York was Rockefeller University. And it has been a high pinnacle of my views of New York ever since then. It's an honor to be invited to speak in this series. There have been some wonderful speakers in this series, and I'm envious of you who have attended these, and I'm also envious of you, those of you who are so close to this wonderful university. What I'd like to do today is take the kind of things that I do in the laboratory and the kinds of things that we all care about as parents and try to bring them together a little bit and give you a glimpse of the brain as it develops from the very earliest stages. As you just heard, the subtitle of my book is How the Mind Grows from Conception to College, and that's a bit of a mouthful. So I'd like you to just think about the main theme that I'd like to address tonight in the next few minutes of as being the learning brain. And I want to talk about the brain as it develops on its own and as it learns, both on its own and also thanks to things that we do for our children, but really also things that they do for themselves. And I want to talk just briefly about why I wrote this book, Welcome to Your Child's Brain. As I said, I'm a working neuroscientist. This, in fact, is one nerve cell, one neuron from a mammalian brain, and I filled this particular neuron with fluorescent dye so that it could be seen. And it's one of a galaxy of neurons, and you can't see its neighbors because they're not filled with fluorescent dye, but I filled this, and you can see that even in a single neuron is incredibly complex. And this brain initiative that you've been hearing about in the news in the last week or so is an initiative to develop technologies to start understanding how these brain cells interact with one another. But the reason I came to write Welcome to Your Child's Brain had to do with something else in my life, which is that about 6 years ago, we discovered that we were going to be parents. And I got really interested in that. And like any good academic, I waited until the very last minute to learn about children. And having waited till the last minute, I went to the bookshelf, I went to the library, and I discovered that there were remarkably few books about child development specifically having to do with how brains develop. We have lots of books we can find on the shelf about healthy sleep habits, healthy child, or about talking to children, raising good children, all these things that are very interesting about children. If you stop and think about those books, in some implicit sense, many of them are about children's brains, right? Because as my introducer well knows, being a pioneer in the area, what is sleep but a thing that is produced by the brain? And if you think about other aspects of brain function, those aspects are reflected in what we read about when we are trying to get our children to do what we want, when we are trying to get them to discover what they want, whatever it is that we might expect from our children or hope for them, what we dream of for them involves the brain. So in the end, I realized that in fact it was important to, I got interested in looking into the literature, making these connections, and discovering how neuroscience related to what was about to enter our lives. And that was the product of that was the book. Now, what I'd like to do is, for those of you who don't have that much technical background, to talk a little bit about the brain. Let me just talk about the kinds of things that we might want to know about, the kinds of things that I, as a researcher, am interested in. Let's just look over here on this diagram. These are the things that we care very much about, both in ourselves and in children, right? Personality, memory, identity, who we are as individuals, who our children are, their individual personalities, and function, and sometimes dysfunction, when things don't quite go as we expect. But from a scientist's point of view, it's possible to start taking these qualities and trace them back through this organ that generates all these things, and go back and look at the basic biology. And if you think about the basic biology, we inherit genes in some shuffled combination that we get from our parents. Those genes set up a developmental program that is surprisingly robust and works on its own in many ways to produce a growing brain. But then that growing brain collides with the world, collides with experience and environmental factors. And those biological mechanisms working together are what ultimately make all these things that we care so much about. And what I'd like to show you is a little glimpse of principles that emerge from these kinds of factors that we study in the laboratory and that many people here at Rockefeller study. And I want to talk about how these factors work together in a scientific sense, but importantly, what I want to do is just drop a few bombs along the way about how they affect how we view our children as parents of those growing things, those growing beings in our lives. And by the way, I should say that there are some beliefs that I think some of you might hold dear, and I hope to give you new evidence that makes you see those beliefs just a little bit differently tonight. Okay, so let's think of the human brain. And it's this 3-pound thing. If you like metric, it's 1.2 kilograms. And it's a pretty small part of our total body weight, right? But in fact, it uses a larger fraction of the power. Our total energy budget is about 70 watts. We use about 15 of those watts to power this brain. And so in fact, in some sense, it's a real energy hog. But in some sense, it's actually an amazingly efficient device, right? So this laptop in front of me uses 15 watts when it's idling. It's using more power right now because it's working really hard to put this up on the screen. So each of us is using an amount of power that's similar to this thing when it's idling. Just to idle, it has to use the amount of power that we're using. So if you think about that, that's fairly amazing that all the things that we do with 15 watts. I should say, by the way, that this lower number, 70 watts, is much smaller in a child. So that a 5-year-old child spends about half of her calories powering her brain and building that brain. So whenever you're putting the, you know, whatever it is, turkey or hummus or cookies or pizza or broccoli or whatever it might be, about half of what you put into that 5-year-old is going to power her brain. So it's an amazing device. It uses also about as much power as the light inside the refrigerator when it's on. And if you think about that, in some sense, that makes us all dim bulbs in a literal sense. But really amazing in other ways, right? Amazing that the so-called dim bulb can do all the things that we do. Okay, so I was going to talk about the biology. This is just a little bit of neural development 101. Think of this developing brain as something that works remarkably on its own. It's remarkably robust. And I'm going to talk about this as I continue in the next few minutes in the context of normal functions as they develop, also abnormal functions, things that aren't quite what we expect. That includes things like autism, ADHD, other things. And I'll be hoping to get some questions on those. But let me talk about brain development. The genetic program is a remarkably robust thing. If you stop and think about it, it's rather amazing. The genes that we inherit from our parents get shuffled, put back together, and set in motion a set of developmental steps that work remarkably on its own. And many of these developmental steps do not require any experience, right? We don't have to do anything special other than provide a well-nourished mom in a pretty good environment, right? And that pretty good environment is enough to allow all these steps to take place. If you know anything about the scientific work of Mark Tessier Levine, Dr. Levine, President Levine, Tessier Levine has made fundamental contributions to how axons grow and find their way. And many of those developmental steps, axons finding their targets, axons are the output wires of brain cells. Those axons find their way seemingly on their own, without special input, and lead to the folding and the establishment and the maturation of this brain. And right around this time, the fetus's brain starts becoming a little bit aware of its environment. So it starts being able to hear dull sounds, very filtered, starts being able to smell and taste things. So for instance, turns out that a fetus around this time, right around birth, drinks about a pint of amniotic fluid a day, right? It just goes right through. And that fetus can therefore learn flavor preferences, and it begins to experience the environment, and it begins to do things like tolerate garlic. So if mom eats garlic at this phase, that baby will, several years later, tolerate garlic, right? Even as a baby, tolerate garlic added to formula. Same, by the way, for broccoli, okay? Right? So there's all kinds of things. Rabbit moms fed juniper-flavored chow. Juniper is not very nice tasting for pups. Rabbit moms who get fed juniper-flavored chow have rabbit pups who will tolerate juniper flavoring in their milk. Right? So there are all kinds of things that you can do here as this brain, which at first developed on its own, starts to experience the world all filtered through mom. Okay, now once children are born, we discover things about them. And as I said before, brains develop mostly on their own, right? Only a normal, loving environment is required for a lot of the developmental steps. We don't need to teach our children to see. We don't need to teach them to hear or to play. There are many things that children do for themselves. And children are very much the agents of their own learning. And so I have to say that one big message that has come from my reading in neuroscience for any parent is that actually, in many respects, you can relax because many of the things they do for themselves. They seek out their own experiences. In many respects, you don't have to teach them a lot of things. And furthermore, for good and maybe for bad, they also learn from their peers. And so much of their experience comes from them. But I want to talk about how this learning turns out a little bit differently. We are often taught in our humanities classes about the blank slate, right? The idea that all babies are born with the capacity to learn, and then in some respect, they all start from the same place. One thing that comes up over and over again in neuroscience and in genetics and in other areas of biology is that that is not the case. And I'll be glad to talk about that during questions. Children begin to show themselves as being somewhat different pretty early on in life. This is a nice daycare center at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, where people at the very beginning of their careers are here, and people later on in their careers also work at the Institute. But you can see here that that this little girl and this little boy seem to be doing somewhat different things. These are three-year-olds, and I will point out to you that they seem to have different toy preferences. And this little boy here is playing with a truck. This little girl here is playing with a stuffed dog, I think. And if you stop and think about that, that is a thing that we often see in little girls and little boys, right? And the point I want to make here is that these preferences are visible quite early in life, and they are not the same. And so when you think about the so-called blank slate, that slate that emerges into your lives when you become parents is not entirely blank. Now, you might be inclined to think that perhaps this is some kind of cultural thing. Perhaps we say to our little girls and little boys that it's nice for them to play with dolls or trucks or hammers or what have you. But I want to just give you one piece of evidence that that might not be the case, and it's this. These are vervet monkeys, and this boy vervet monkey is playing with a little police car, a thing, vroom, vroom. It's got wheels that it can push it around. Probably doesn't know it's a car, but it knows it's a thing it can push around. If you look at this girl vervet monkey, it is performing, if you look down here, it says, it appears to be making an anogenital inspection of the toy doll, okay? And if you've ever met a vervet monkey, which you might, at the zoo, they do that a lot. Moms do that a lot. And so you can see here that there seems to be some kind of sex preference, and that's interesting. Now, I should back up a step and say that, in fact, in many respects, men and women are quite similar. If you look at aptitude tests and all the different kinds of ways that we can test anything from reaction time to math ability to verbal ability, on average, men and women are quite similar. It's remarkably hard to find differences between men and women when it comes to these aptitude tests. Needless to say, we have a lot of interest in that as men and women. But this is one of the larger differences, toy preferences. And I show it as an example of showing one way in which individuals start being pretty different from each other. And just briefly on the subject of boy-girl differences, this is just some simple distributions. If you're good at reading histograms at all, this is the famous bell curve where you can see somebody who's a lot in this direction or a lot in this direction with most people in the middle. If you look at boys and girls are remarkably similar in a lot of capacities. And I've shown you the biggest difference that's known of all the sex differences, which is a preference for tools and toy guns versus a preference for dolls. And that's an effect size of 1.9 standard deviations. And so what that means is that the average girl prefers dolls more than 92% of boys. The average boy prefers guns over dolls more than 92% of girls. So that's a pretty large difference. But look at all these things that are much less different, right? So I've told you that we have individual preferences, and they come out in different ways in individuals, but not necessarily according to the boy-girl divide. So for instance, boys on average decide conflicts based on justice more than girls. Girls decide based on relationships rather than justice more than boys. Certainly enough for people to get nice peer-reviewed publications, right? But not necessarily enough for us to care when confronted with one boy in front of us or one girl in front of us. And so that's a difference between peer-reviewed literature and what might matter to us in our everyday lives. And then on down the list, things like activity level and aggression, which you won't be surprised to hear are more prominent in little boys than little girls, but not by very much. Fine motor coordination and concentration in girls, again, not by much. And so on and on down this list, things like the ability to rotate mental objects as an adult, so men are slightly better at imagining how that couch is going to get through the doorway than women. Women are somewhat better at remembering where those keys are. They're on the counter where you left them. Okay? So, and it goes to show that, in fact, whatever you may think of your partner's mental abilities, if he is given the job of getting the couch through the door, that might be a good job for him. So, but anyway, you get the idea. Okay, so the main message is that people are different, but not necessarily as much as we think they are based on sex. And so we do have to pay attention to differences, but it's only a few things where sex really matters a lot. So now I want to turn to the subject of learning, and I said at the beginning that I was going to talk about the learning brain. And I want you to think about brains of your children and your own brain as a physical organ. And in fact, if we think about the brain initiative that we've been hearing about in the news, it's not one organ, but actually 100 organs. The brain is this amazing set of organs that all talk to one another, processing information. And a thing that the brain does throughout life is it changes. And this is a cartoon of an infant pruning its own brain, doing something with its own brain. And I want to give you the feeling right now, in the few slides I'm going to show remaining, that the brain is a physical organ that changes throughout life. It changes both because of biological programs that are set in motion by those genes that I mentioned before. It also, in addition to those autonomous genetic programs, relies on experience to change. And in fact, what I'm showing here is, in some sense, pruning. This baby is pruning its own brain. And what's interesting about that metaphor is that it's more than a metaphor. As it turns out, the number of synapses in the brain goes up from birth, and synapses, the connections between neurons, proliferate massively and reach a peak number at about 1 year of age. And that number of connections within a brain, whether it be of a monkey or a human being, that number of connections peaks around age one. But look at what's happening here. As they get older, that number of connections goes down. And that's kind of curious, because if you look at this graph here, it's a little bit hard to read, but if you see here, this is at birth, and this is at months 2 through 12 postnatal, right? So babies in the first year of life, the number of connections is going up. It's these connections are increasing at the rates of millions of connections per second, right? So you've got this baby in front of you, the baby's really cute, and there's this volcano of synapses being formed, right? Just at this incredible rate. I mean, it's a fairly stunning rate. And that number of synapses goes up, peaks around age one, but then look what happens, goes down. And by about age five, so this is now 2 through 70, by about age five, that number of synapses has declined. And in fact, in the first six years of life, babies lose half their synapses. Now, if we stop and think about that, that's a little bit strange, right? Because babies and children are gaining capability at a mad rate, right? Our daughter is about to turn six, and it has been an amazing sight watching her learn things. Her head has been exploding with knowledge. Starting school, learning from peers. I'll come to that in a moment. But the number of connections goes down. And what that means is that this pruning is not bad. It's not bad to lose synapses, especially early in development. What's happening in this process is that this pruning is, in fact, getting rid of connections that are not important for certain functions. There's this proliferation in which many possibilities are formed, and then experience starts snipping away, snip, 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 and then you get this beautifully formed topiary. And so what's happening, paradoxically, is a disappearance of connections in the developing brain. And that's what's going on as children develop in the first years of life. Okay, likewise, the energy use goes up, and so this is the energy use per gram tissue. Remember I told you that half of those calories go to power her brain or his brain. And that likewise peaks around this time, a little bit later than this, and then declines. And so this volcano is in fact a very hot volcano. It's a torch. And there's just this amazing amount of energy consumption happening in these young brains. So one way in which these children learn is by exploring their environments and experiencing what's fun for them, right? If we think about what play is for, if I were to ask you what's play for, why do we play? There's a natural answer, right? The natural answer is, well, because it's fun. Why else would you play? Okay, but why is it fun? And what's interesting about that is that the reason that play is fun appears to be that children and adults and young animals and older animals play. They frolic, right? Deer frolic, cats will playfully bat around a ball. If you have a pet cat, that activity gets a little bit less cute when they come in and they give you a present that they found outside, right? So there are things that animals and we do. And what these little girls are doing is playing. And it turns out that play is a form of learning. In that play, brain neurotransmitter systems, including dopamine and norepinephrine, are activated. Those neurotransmitter systems are really good for learning mechanisms. Mechanisms referred to as synaptic plasticity, where the strength of synapses goes up, the strength of synapses goes down, connections are formed, or maybe broken. And all of that neural plasticity is probably operating quite well when children are playing. And these little girls are playing a complex game. And what's interesting about this complex game they're playing, where there's a tea party, and I guess this rock here is maybe a nice pastry, and then we've got a nice cup of tea. There's all kinds of stuff going on here. It turns out that these elaborate games are, in fact, times when they are learning a lot. turns out that this complex play is an important part in children's lives. As I mentioned, the dopamine system gets activated, and dopamine is radiated by clusters of neurons here at the brain's core, places like the ventral tegmental area, which gives us a sense of reward. If you walk down the street and you see an old friend, that's rewarding. If you walk down the street and you see a large denomination bill lying on the sidewalk, that would also be obviously kind of rewarding, right? And so there's this reward center that gets activated when children and adults are playing, and it sends its projections all around the brain, sending a signal saying, that was good, you should do that again. Right? Likewise, the noradrenergic system, this is a system that comes from a place called the locus coeruleus, which is Latin for the blue place. If you ever dissect a brain, it looks a little blue. And again, this is a brain region that in fact turns on the senses. It's currently believed that this is a brain region that in some sense turns up the volume of sensations. Right? So for instance, if you're in anything from an exhilarating event that you enjoy, or if you're in a car crash where you remember everything that happened in the car crash, those kinds of events are events that get the adrenaline going, right? Noradrenaline. So these brain systems are quite important for learning. But what's interesting is that a lot of this learning happens from peers. I mentioned before that that you obviously provide a loving environment for your children, but much of their interaction, if you think about it, doesn't come from you. It comes from their peers. And it turns out that one big way that children learn is from their older peers. Because you learn, I mean, think about it. If you're trying to improve your tennis game, you probably are going to learn more if you play with someone who's slightly better than you are, right? That's what you do to get better at tennis. And whatever it might be, you get better by stretching yourself a little bit, by reaching a little bit more. And there's a pioneer in psychology named Vygotsky. And Vygotsky came up with a concept well before the biology of the learning brain was ever established, was ever discovered, called the zone of proximal competence. The idea that we get to the edge of our zone and get a little bit better and reach a little bit. And it turns out that this has an application. And the application came out in this column that I wrote for the New York Times a few years ago. I did not pick this headline, okay? My editor picked this headline. I did not say that your child is in peril, but he laughed his head off. He thought that was great to really get the parents going. You know, am I imperiling my child? Thanks, pal. This is relevant to a common practice. It is increasingly common for parents who are really interested in their child's advancement to hold those children back from entering kindergarten. I think some of you have heard of this practice. It's called redshirting, right? Where your kid's ready to enter kindergarten and you think, maybe I would like him or her, usually him in most cases, to maybe hold back for a year. And this is popularized by people like Malcolm Gladwell, who very helpfully writing about Canadian hockey players has generalized that lesson about Canadian hockey players to your children, okay? And the idea is that somehow this is good for children to be held back from entering kindergarten for a year. So my co-author Sandra Ammon and I wrote this piece pointing out that if you look at the literature carefully, it turns out that there is a slight advantage, and the slight advantage goes to children who are not redshirted. The slight advantage goes to children who are young for their year. So if you look at intellectual growth in children as they get older, it goes like this, and it jumps. And it turns out that old third graders are slightly, let's see, I can never do it with hand gestures, but the idea is that children who are old for third grade don't do as well as children who are young for fourth grade. Okay, so the idea there is that if you are young for your year, you are slightly better at these gains, right, of academic accomplishment. And what's interesting, right, is that we, in fact, are trying to do well by our children. Now, this is not a big difference, so don't get too heartbroken. But the idea is that we learn from our peers, and our children learn from their peers, right? And that's interesting, and it has to do with the fact that it's complex play. We get into this kind of complex play, we learn from our peers, and they are learning from their peers. And so that's an important lesson, I think, that comes from the fact that they spend a lot of their time with their peers, not with us. Now, it turns out that one thing that happens in a lot of these cases is the building of self-restraint. You've heard about the marshmallow test, right, where children who are very good at resisting that reward, who are 3 or 4 years old, turn out to, in fact, do quite well in school. They're thought of well by their peers, not only when they're 4 years old, when they take the year that they take the test, but even 14 years later when they're in high school, right? Willpower is a resource that can be built up. And one thing that emerges from all these things that I'm telling you is that complex play, a la Vygotsky, is a thing that can help build up self-restraint at all ages. If you help your child discover a thing that he or she loves, becomes passionate about, will spend all his time doing, whatever it might be, if it requires sustained mental effort, that is a major tool for building self-restraint. And it's been demonstrated that that self-restraint is the basis for things like the marshmallow test, like doing better in school. All these things that we do for our kids, like get them interested in Taekwondo or whatever it might be, if they get worked up about it enough to do it all the time, they're going to get better at it, they're going to spend time at it. And the reason I'm showing you this silly slide is that it's a thing that you can do too. If you are interested in trying this out on yourself, you can do an experiment on yourself, which is as follows. If you brush your teeth with the wrong hand for 2 weeks at home, you will undergo a slight increase in your willpower capacity because you use the same capacity to overcome your resistance to using the wrong hand. And after the end of that 2 weeks, you'll be more likely to stick with a diet. You will be more likely to stick with an exercise program, right? Your willpower can be built up like a muscle, and your children's willpower can be built up like a muscle by him or her finding things that he's passionate about, that she's passionate about, right? So the idea is that willpower is a thing that's built up with use, right? Cells that fire together, wire together. That's a core principle of neuroscience, and it's a core principle that predicts the idea that circuits that are used get more skilled at that, okay? So that's something you can try out at home. I want to report back on that. Okay, so the idea here is that this nerve cell, this brain cell here with its axon coming out and sending out its connections, that it can be built up with practice, right? And it's not necessarily the single cell, but I just like this cartoon. Okay, so I'm a little bit behind, but let me just take a couple minutes and show you what happens a little bit later in development. Later in development, this is now a brain, a time-lapse movie where this is the back of the brain, this is the front of the brain, and what I'm showing you here is the brain going from blue in the back to spreading out and being blue in its throughout its entire expanse. And the point of this movie is that the back of the brain here is the sensory areas that include things like vision. The front of the brain is prefrontal, this famous prefrontal cortex that's important for self-restraint, that's probably involved in things like exercising willpower, in restraining impulses, in making a good impression on other people. And the point here is that you can see that it develops from back to front from age 8 to 18, and this frontal part is suspiciously slow in coming to full maturity. And perhaps that's not surprising, right? Because if you think about adolescence as a time of impulsivity, when it's hard to restrain impulses. Now, adolescence, as it turns out, is also a very good time because it's a time when people become autonomous, they start being able to explore their environments and so on. So it's a really good time for children in many ways because they're starting to learn a lot about the world. Okay, in my remaining 1 or 2 minutes, I want to just mention that this genetic program that makes us all a little bit different pertains to many normal skills, like numerical ability, verbal ability, but it also pertains to many abnormal things, things that we would not necessarily wish for ourselves for our children, things like bipolar, autism, substance abuse, right? And so the idea here, and I'm not going to get into the technical aspects of this because I think time won't really permit it, but the idea is that if something is completely heritable, this H squared quantity is 1, and if it's not heritable at all, it's 0. So heritability is quite high. You can really predict how tall a kid is going to be by looking at his or her parents. Acne, children cannot blame their parents for acne. Okay, this is just no blame there because the heritability is close to 0. But if you look at all these things, many things are in fact partially heritable. And what that means is that that genetic program, that deck shuffling that happens at the beginning, at conception, plays itself out in many ways, both for outcomes that our tax dollars work very hard to in the laboratories of places like Rockefeller and others, and also build normal capacities. And I want to talk about now autism just for a moment. Autism is something that happens with increasing frequency, at least at the level of diagnosis in the United States. And I want to just put into perspective what does and does not cause autism. And much of it comes back to genetics, and I'll be glad to take questions about that. Now, you hear a lot about these factors here in the popular press, things like vaccination, having an older mom or an older dad. But relative to the general population, the rate of autism is not altered by vaccination at all. It's one of the best studied questions, and it turns out the change in autism rates is nil, as far as anybody can tell. Now, sometimes you hear about increases in risk with moms and dads, small increase in risk, lots of news stories to make us feel bad about whatever life choices we might be making. But in fact, that's not a very large risk. Other factors that we don't hear about as much have a higher risk. Elective cesarean, right? So if it's an unnecessary cesarean, the risk goes up a little bit. Women who emigrate while pregnant, that's a very hard thing to do, to emigrate while pregnant, And one of the sponsors of this series, the faculty sponsors, Bruce McCune, is a pioneer in understanding stress mechanisms. And it's likely that things like fleeing a hurricane while you're pregnant during the third trimester, or emigrating from your home country while pregnant, right? One possibility is that stress hormones may affect the developing brain and increase the risk of autism. Prematurity, more than 6 weeks premature. Now this gets back to experience, the Romanian orphanage, right? This is a famous study in which being put in an orphanage with no social care, no love, no hugging or whatever, dramatically increases the risk of autism. And I want to back up a step here before I show you the punchline of this. The point I'm trying to make here with this graph is that I told you that experience was not necessary, but it turns out that a little bit of experience is necessary. And so depriving children of that normal, loving care turns out to be a pretty big risk. And I want to back up a step and talk about this a little bit and point out that these factors tell us something about what the brain needs when it's growing, what affects it while it's growing, and it also tells us about ourselves, those of us who are not necessarily off the scale. But there's a punchline coming, which is that there are factors that I mentioned at the beginning, right? Genetics plays quite a powerful role here, right? So what's known, as far as anyone can tell, is that the whole ball of wax is set in motion by what we inherit from our parents. So the general idea is that we hear about this in the news, media coverage to the left, and we don't hear about lots of these things. And so what it turns out is that, in fact, the second and third trimester is pretty important. Prenatal stress may be important. And perhaps experience, right? Experience coming into the developing neocortex as per the Romanian orphanage. So it may be that we just need a normal environment, but we do need that normal environment. And finally, genetic factors. Okay, now what's interesting here, I won't have time to talk about it, my own favorite part of the brain, the cerebellum, is right in here. Turns out the cerebellum may be a trigger of autism in a few cases, and perhaps the cerebellum is a guide of development. And I'll just very briefly say that these same genes may affect the normal brain as well. I had the good fortune to survey the incoming freshman class a few years ago. Turns out that incoming freshmen will do anything you ask them to do, including fill out a survey. I got a 90% response rate on this survey. That never happens. Okay. And I asked them about their family members. I asked them about autism, ADHD, other things, Alzheimer's disease. And I also asked them, well, what do you think your major is going to be? And what's interesting was that I found something that links the two things I've been telling you about. One is about children who are in the normal range, and the other is about children who get outside the normal range. It turns out that the same genes may govern both outcomes. And it turns out those genes that make us so different from one another in toy preference or in liking humanities or sciences, those same genes may drive outcomes that are off the scale as well. So at the time that I did this study, the general rate of reported autism in the population is about 1 in 160. In the case of siblings of humanities and social science majors, somewhat higher, but Princeton kids turn out to come from multi-children families on average, and so when you work out the statistics, this comes out to be about the same. But in fact, siblings of science, math, and engineering majors, much higher, about three times higher. And in fact, as it turns out, I haven't told you that I am one of these people. My sister is autistic, and I majored in physics in college. The point that I'm trying to make here is that this opens up the possibility that the same genes that make us different from one another also, in certain combinations, may lead to autism. And that's interesting to me because it starts to link up normal development, which I've spent much of my time talking about, and development that doesn't go as we plan. Right? And that's interesting. So there's a reason, perhaps, that those genes are in there. Okay, so if you look among, again, Princeton students who have the liberty of pursuing what they like, if they have autism in their families but not depression, bipolar, or substance abuse, they're very likely to be technical majors. If they have these things in their families but not autism, then they are very likely to be humanists or social scientists. And in my laboratory, we're very interested in studying these mechanisms in the cerebellum, and we use these optical methods that you've been hearing about in the Brain Initiative to study how the cerebellum may, in fact, be a teacher to the rest of the brain. And I'm very interested in the possibility that things like the Romanian orphanage phenomenon are versions of the neocortex not getting the input that it needs in order to develop normally. And so I am hoping that, in fact, our studies of how the cerebellum guides brain development may, in fact, inform both autism and also how we all become the people that we would like to be and that we would like our children to be. So I've gone over time, I apologize for that, but I'd be delighted to now take questions. Thanks very much.
Sorry about going over.
No, this is fine. So I'd first like to thank Sam for this discussion. In the remaining time, we'll take a few questions from the audience.
In the 6 years you've been a father, you've undoubtedly made lots of decisions and changed. What do you suppose you do differently than someone like me does, not knowing as much as you do?
That is such a good question. I would say that one thing I do, I wasn't kidding before when I said that there are many things that I don't worry about quite as much. So environment plays a role in children's personality and intellectual development and in their social development. But it turns out that surprisingly little of that environment is traceable to parents. And what that translates to is that we make important decisions for our children, like where to live, right? Who they associate with. And if they are surrounded by good peers in what's called a high SES environment, socioeconomic status, if you can pick good peers for them, that turns out to be a large part of the battle. Helping them find things that they love and will pursue on their own is another large part of the battle. And if you can find them those things that they're passionate about, it turns out that that turns them pretty autonomous. And so that's one thing that I do that might be different. And I view watching her develop as something like being some waiter in a crazy restaurant where we're bringing out things and showing her, do you like that? Do you like that? Or whether it be dance or music or math or whatever. And looking for the thing that's just going to make her pop. And, you know, then I can kick back. Right? And so there's a thing there that we're trying to do, which is to find what is really great for her and will become autonomous in her. I think that it's really important to keep in mind that there's certain moments that are important. Finding slightly better peers. And also, as I said, not worrying too much about little things that we may or may not do. So that's my answer.
Dr. Wang, I was just wondering, you alluded to math and verbal abilities in your study. Math and verbal abilities of your...
You're talking about the heritability.
Heritability, yes. And I wonder if there's... you said that there's a complex inheritance for those abilities.
Right.
I wonder if you studied the culture of the different individuals and also the nutritional histories of these individuals and the SES, wouldn't that have a tremendous effect on your graph here?
Yeah, so let me clarify a little bit. Now, when I talk about heritability, this is a combination of many genes working together. So it's not the case that there is a math gene or a language gene or whatever it might be. There's some deck that gets shuffled.
My question is that, can that be altered in later life? For instance, let's say in prenatal care, would the nutrition affect that outcome later on?
Well, one thing that's really quite important is pre-K, especially in so generally speaking, early life experiences, things like preschool and so on, can be quite good for mental development. I'm not sure what you're getting at,
I'm just wondering, because there's such a big discussion on, let's say, the test score gap between different groups and what the causes are of the test score gap, which is more than 1.2 standard deviation.
Right.
Between different racial and ethnic groups.
New York parents think about tests a lot.
No, that's...
Yeah.
That's a fact.
In serious answer to your question, there are very clearly early life environmental factors. If you take children from low SES backgrounds, pre-K does a lot for them. And so what appears to be consistent with the data is that in households with not very strong resources, pre-K makes a big difference in affecting outcomes. And so think of genetic inheritance, as in this slide, as being the possible range of possibilities. And then think of the environment as being water that falls on that seed and, you know, growing it to a flower. And so in some sense, environment is limiting. That would be my answer to your question.
So in other words, such a genetic component.
I'd love to talk this over with you offline. So why don't we talk about that some more?
We have a question over here.
Thank you for a wonderful presentation. I have a question about sleep and its function in learning and memory. And then I have a more specific question about whether, if you know that, about night terrors and what kind of role they play in the developing brain.
This is very interesting. So I will first give the disclaimer that if you're asking about sleep, we can talk to Dr. Young afterwards and perhaps get another perspective on it. It's like that scene in that Woody Allen movie where Marshall McLuhan is behind the poster, right? I just happen to have Marshall McLuhan right here. You know nothing of my work. Okay, so, grade me afterwards. Okay, so the answer is that during sleep, the brain appears not to be idle. And what appears to be the case is that there's reprocessing of memories. Memory is not write once, read many times like a computer, but memories seem to be reprocessed during sleep, both in children, probably, and certainly in adults. And so sleep is an important time because it's not only a time for the body and brain to be replenished, but also a time when memories are consolidated and, you know, straightened out and all put together. As far as dreaming goes, one thing that's interesting is that you can look into the dreams of children and they give you a little bit of information of what kinds of thoughts they're capable of. So if you ask children, say, at the age of 3 or 4, what they saw while they were sleeping, you have to be careful about asking the question because you can't say dreaming because they don't necessarily know what that was. But if you say, what did you see while you were sleeping? It will typically be something pretty passive. I was sleeping in a bathtub. Or it was a chicken eating corn. Those are fairly typical things. There's not a lot of movement. And then later, around age 6 or 7, on average, then movement starts becoming apparent. So there seems to be something about what children are able to imagine. At least that's what the interpretation is. As far as what you're asking about night terrors, one thing that's interesting there is that night terrors seem to be different from nightmares. There's something about them. They're not remembered usually, typically, when they wake up. And I would say that speculatively what that is lack of suppression of those emotional centers during sleep, so that there's this unnameable terror that happens. But one thing that's remarkable about that is that those terrors are usually not remembered. And so I think, generally speaking, you should be less concerned about those they're awful to watch, right? But they're actually probably innocuous. They're basically the child learning how to sleep. This is the short answer. Yes.
Have you done any research or do you have any information about what happens to kids' brains when they're playing video games? Because there's so much concern from parents about kids
yes.
spending time on computers and video
this
games.
This is so interesting. Right, this is a fascinating question. Obviously, we should be concerned a lot about technology, whether it be video games or texting or email. I will answer your question directly and say that those... here are some interesting facts about video games, especially violent video games of the shoot 'em up variety. Stress hormones in the brain, such as cortisol, go down when you play violent video games. Okay, don't go up, go down. Kids and also grown-ups who play those action video games are better at tracking multiple objects, better at attending to multiple stimuli. Laparoscopic surgeons who are inveterate video game players are better at their surgery. So you might not like video games, but if you've got to go get surgery, see what the surgeon does in their spare time. So there are unexpected pluses that come from those video games. Now, I'll give the minus of technology, and I'll get into the realm of speculation. The minus of many technologies is that our brains do well what they do often. And if you look at a Pew survey, there's a Pew Center survey that shows that empathy scores in the last decade, have notably gone down. And these are questions like, before choosing a course of action, I think about how it'll affect other people. Now, if you stop and think about our social interactions, much of our social lives are now spent online, with text messaging, with email, and so on. And if somebody is annoying you online, you can walk away. And we get lots more practice at social interactions that don't involve live people. And so if you're in line getting your coffee, and the person in front of you is texting instead of talking to the barista or talking to you or getting out of your way, that person is engaging in his or her social life through the text device and not through live people. So I would say that video games are an obvious concern, but there are a lot of technologies in our lives, and I think we should broaden our concern a little bit to all these other things that we do with technology that have started to fill our heads. And I am very concerned about that.
Can you give some examples of things we should be concerned about with the technologies?
I see. I'm sorry. I thought I had. I kind of made it kind of mysterious. right. No, I just think that what I'm trying to point out is that there's a correlation between decline in empathy scores and increased use of texting and email. And much of what we do is now mediated through those devices, and so we probably should be somewhat concerned about developing social selves, being nice people to one another. And that is something that is very hard to practice in a video game, unless it's exactly the right kind of video game. So that was my concern.
There's been a lot of attention in the media lately about sports trauma to the brain, specifically with adolescents playing soccer and football and other sports like that. Have you looked at adolescent brain trauma, specifically concussions, and what impact that may have on the developmental brain?
I don't know that literature too well, but it is, I will say that that concussive injury is a major source of concern, I think. I've certainly met parents at Princeton who, one whose boy is on the lacrosse team, and he took a check right here and was floored on the field. And for the next half year or so was in a black depression, wouldn't come out of his room, and was changing his personality. So I would say, generally speaking, that that one should be extremely concerned about contact sports that lead to possible concussion. And I don't know about long-term outcomes, but it is hard to imagine that they would be very different from what we see in, say, professional football players.
Thank you. Another area that's gotten a lot of press coverage recently is ADHD and medications and over-medication of children. Can you tell us a little bit about what that does to the developing brain, you know, taking these medications, and is that, you know, if you
right.
can
okay.
shed some
so
light
I'll,
on
I'll be very brief about this. Generally speaking, ADHD, I will first say, appears to be a real phenomenon in the sense that the genetics are beginning to be understood, and one can define it according to a checklist of inattentiveness in many situations. So I'll first say that ADHD is in some deep sense a real phenomenon. It's probably a problem in which the brain is slightly slower to develop, and so the reason I'm showing this is that this pattern that I showed you in this movie is in some sense delayed by about a year or two in kids with ADHD. And what that means is that it's just normal development, except some kids are like Huck Finn and want to go down the river Mississippi, and other kids are able to sit still in class and be good boys and girls. And about 50% of kids with ADHD resolve by age 18. And so in many respects, it's just a slight delay. Now, you're asking about Ritalin and other drugs like that. It turns out that if you look at the statistics, there is not an increased risk of drug abuse among children who use Ritalin. And it appears to be more the case that if children are prone towards abuse, then if Ritalin is available, then that will be the thing that they abuse. And so Ritalin appears to be not of increased risk for addiction, which may be the thing you're asking about. Is that roughly what you're asking?
No, I was actually asking about the physics of the brain.
Okay. Right. It appears to not have ill long-term effects, and there are benefits that come from the ability to focus attention. Now, if you don't like filling your child's head with drugs that are that have the same chemical job as cocaine and methamphetamine, which you might not like, that another way to get these gains can come from neurofeedback. There are devices, basically video games, to entrain brain patterns. And this thing called neurobiofeedback has an effect that is about as large as that of Ritalin. Except with Ritalin, you know, you take the pill and the kid gets better in front of you, but the game, you have to do it for a while, right? So there's a difference between them.
Thank you so much. I found your talk very interesting. The thing that you worry less now about is your parenting, but you do worry more about the impact of peers. And so I'm curious, living in New York, as you said, a lot of people are concerned about test scores. A lot of people are also concerned about where to send their child to school, public versus private. And in private schools, there's a lot of wealthy people. The parents obviously are smarter. Maybe they are making more money, possibly, maybe not, I don't know. But there seems to be, from my own experience, a lot of people who can afford to maybe have the parties that have an effect with the peers in terms of drugs and alcohol and things like that. Where do you send your kids? Do you send them to public school or private school?
We send our girl to the local public school, and this morning she rode on the back of my tandem bike, and it was a 5-minute bike ride, and I dropped her off. That was what we did.
Thank you.
What's that? We don't live in New York. Okay. So I will back up and say that I have a lot of feeling for parents who live in New York City, because watching it from a distance, it is a remarkable and intense activity to get your child placed in school. 98th percentile, sorry. 99th percentile, oh yes, maybe you can get into the lottery for the, you know, Nest school or whatever. I mean, just, I find the whole New York activity to be incredible because the amount of effort that parents are willing to go to, it's like this little microcosm of being a New Yorker. And I will say that the one, I'll say a good thing about it, which is that I think it is positive to pick good peers for your child. But there are different ways to get it. In our case, we're very fortunate because, as it turns out, our daughter's peers are children of Princeton faculty. And there's, you know, those are pretty good peers. And we get a little tiny version of this. There are two kindergarten teachers. One is a very experienced teacher. The other one is brand new. There are all these helicopter parents who made sure that their kid got into the experienced kindergarten teacher's class. You know, we were gossiping with them. Oh, where did your kid get in? Oh, well, she's with, you know, Miss Rita, who's the new teacher. And they say, oh. And we're like, what? She seems like a nice person. It turns out that the best kindergarten teacher is the one who is in her first year of ever doing it. She's filled with fire and energy and is spending all her time coming up with little activities and so on. But to get back to your point a little bit, I think that there's value in being concerned about that, but I think people get more concerned about it than they have to, in the sense that a lot of that learning comes from peers. And so, you know, pretty good peers are probably pretty good enough, and that having peers who are slightly ahead, so if the kid has to work a little bit, then that's probably good. But I think that, as I said, I'll just come back and say I have a lot of feeling for you guys.
Can we thank Sam for this?
Thanks. Thanks, Sam.